First of all, I'd like to say thank you to Elizabeth for taking the time, the effort, and whatever else it takes to put this on every year. I think it's a very important piece of what community education. Secondly, I want to say what an honor it is to be a co-sponsor of this event and how pleased we are to be able to do that. And now I would like to introduce to you your first speaker, Dr. Gil Rabinovici. Born and raised in Jerusalem, Dr. Rabinovici received his BS degree from Stanford University and MD from Northwestern University Medical School. He completed an internship in internal medicine at Stanford University, neurology residency and chief residency at UCSF, and a behavioral neurology fellowship at the Memory and Aging Center, where he has remained on faculty as an attending neurologist. Dr. Rabinovich's research evaluates how structural, functional, and molecular brain imaging techniques can be used to improve diagnostic accuracy in dementia and to study the biology of neurodegenerative diseases. I think I'm going to need some kind of award for all these complicated words. His work is supported by National Institute on Aging, the Alzheimer's Association, the Tau Consortium, and the John Douglas French Alzheimer's Foundation. He is the recipient of the 2012 American Academy of Neurology Research Award in Geriatric Neurology and the 2010 Best Paper in Alzheimer's Disease Neuroimaging New Investigator Award from the Alzheimer's Association. So welcome to Dr. Gil Rabinovici.
Thank you for that very nice introduction. Can everyone hear me? I think I can put this away. So it's always a pleasure to speak at a venue like this and try to bring some of the cutting-edge research that we're doing, I think I'm good, to people who are actually in the front lines, to people who are caring for patients with Alzheimer's disease and dementia. I want to give you a state of the field of Alzheimer's disease in 2014, but I actually thought I'd begin with a bit of historical perspective. Then I'll discuss a bit of the epidemiology and genetics of the disease, which I think increasingly are important as we think about potential therapies. I'll introduce the two main villains in this story, the toxic amyloid plaques and tau tangles that accumulate in the brain and lead the brain to initially to dysfunction and eventually to degenerate. And I'll try to describe a bit of the age-old feud between Baptists and Taoists. So, Baptists are the people who believe that the original sin, if you will, is in the amyloid plaques, whereas the Taoists believe that the road to truth goes through tau. And hopefully I'll be able to present a unionist view of this, because I think both proteins are incredibly important. After getting a little molecular, I want to get back into the clinical setting, and I'll present a case vignette from my own practice, the case of Sergeant M, and I'll try to use this vignette to define some clinical terms that we use in assessing patients with dementia, and also to illustrate how imaging and increasingly biomarkers can help us with the diagnosis and therapy. And I'm going to end by introducing this emerging concept of preclinical disease, the thought that the changes in the brain might begin actually decades before people have the very earliest symptoms. And that's a bit depressing in a way if we think about the fact that many of us will develop this pathology in the brain as we age, but it also, I think, presents an incredible opportunity to intervene, delay, and perhaps prevent the disease altogether. So the history of Alzheimer's disease really begins with a meeting that occurred in a hospital in Frankfurt in 1901, and the patient who was seen, let me see if I can get this laser pointer to work, let's see. So the patient was Augusta Dieter. She was a 51-year-old homemaker, and she was brought into the hospital by her husband because she was having very severe memory impairment, a lot of difficulty expressing herself with language. She was hoarding things in the house. She was increasingly developing delusions and behavioral disturbances. And she was seen by Alice Alzheimer, who was a neurologist slash psychiatrist slash neuropathologist. Doctors were truly Renaissance people in those days. And Alzheimer was really amazed by Augusta Dee and what he called her disease of forgetting. He had never seen this in someone so young. And even though he got a better job offer and moved from Frankfurt to Munich, he stayed in touch with the clinicians who cared for Augusta Dee in Frankfurt. And when she passed away in 1906, he performed a brain autopsy. And what you see here are Alzheimer's actual sketches of what he saw when he looked at the stained brain under the microscope. This is, I think, a very elegant rendition of one of the key pathologic features, the neurofibrillary tangles. And so here's a more modern view of the pathology of Alzheimer's disease, and it illustrates the two key things that the pathologist looks for when they examine the brain of someone suspected of having AD to make the pathologic diagnosis. And so these round circular structures that you see here with a dense core are occurring outside of brain cells in the extracellular space, and these are the amyloid plaques composed primarily of a protein called amyloid beta, or A-beta. Now, these flame-shaped structures that you see here are actually occurring in neurons, in brain cells, and these are the neurofibrillary tangles, and they're composed of a protein called tau. And so the appearance of both of these proteins in the brain are necessary to make the definitive diagnosis at the time of autopsy. Now, Alzheimer presented this as a case report at a psychiatry meeting, and over the next few years, he and his students presented a few additional cases of patients who had this type of disease. And then it's a little hard for us to imagine, but actually for most of the 20th century, Alzheimer's disease of forgetting was a forgotten disease. People thought that Alzheimer's disease was a rare cause of dementia in young people, and that most what was called senility in old people was due to hardening of the arteries or vascular causes. And it really wasn't until the 1970s and even early 80s that people put together the fact that the vast majority of older people who develop dementia late in life have the exact same changes in the brain that Alzheimer had described at the turn of the century. Of course, now we know that not only is Alzheimer's disease not rare, but it has us really on the verge of a public health epidemic. And so it's estimated that about 5.5 million Americans currently have Alzheimer's disease. And because of the aging population, it's estimated that by 2020, so not so far from now, just in 6 years, that number might reach 16 million. What you see here is a map of the United States with the expected increase in prevalence of the disease between 2000 and 2025. So you see, for example, that here in California, we're looking at a 50 to 80% increase in the number of Alzheimer's patients. Now, of course, this translates into a very large burden on our public health system. So Medicare costs in 2010, just to care for Alzheimer's patients, were estimated to be about $170 billion. And by 2050, that number will exceed $1 trillion. Now, because Alzheimer's is a disease of aging, we don't need to completely prevent or eradicate the disease. But if we could just delay the onset of disease an average of 5 years, we could actually reduce someone's lifetime risk by about 50%, reduce the overall health costs by over 50%. And as you'll see at the end of this talk, I don't think that's science fiction. So why do people get Alzheimer's disease? Well, this is no surprise. The number one risk factor is getting older. So the prevalence of the disease is about 1% in people in their early 60s, and then it roughly doubles every 5 years. And so now when you're talking about people over the age of 85, we're talking about a 35 to 40% prevalence of disease. Women are at higher risk for developing Alzheimer's disease, even correcting for the fact that they live longer than men, and this is not really well understood. If you have a first-degree relative, a parent, a sibling with the disease, that increases the risk about fourfold compared to the general population. We'll hear a lot more about head trauma, but people who have sustained head trauma, particularly with loss of consciousness, but maybe not necessarily, are at increased risk for the disease, and there's a lot of interest in this now in the military as well as in professional sports. And people who are less mentally and physically active throughout their lifetime seem to be at higher risk of Alzheimer's disease. Now, this is a little bit of a chicken and the egg question. So are older people becoming less active because they're already in the prodromal stages of dementia, or is there truly a cause and effect? Well, I'll show you that there are more and more data that suggests that our level of physical and cognitive activity in midlife can determine our risk of developing Alzheimer's disease 30 or 40 years later. So I think that's a pretty strong argument, actually, for cause and effect. And then anything that's bad for the heart is bad for the brain. So high blood pressure, diabetes, central obesity, smoking cigarettes, all of these things that we recognize as cardiovascular risk factors are also risk factors for Alzheimer's disease, even correcting for the amount of vascular disease in the brain. All right, what decreases the risk of the disease? Education. So participating in a seminar like this today will decrease your risk, hopefully. More good news, a little alcohol can actually reduce the risk of disease. So I don't encourage my patients to start drinking, but one glass of red wine with dinner is probably not a bad thing. The corollary of what I said earlier, so people who are more mentally and physically active seem to be at lower risk, and then eating healthy also. So the Mediterranean diet is the current fad, a diet that's rich in fruits and vegetables, olive oil instead of butter, fish instead of red meat. All these things seem to actually reduce the risk of the disease. Now, one thing we can't control are the genes that we're dealt, and about 1% of Alzheimer's cases are due to what we call autosomal dominant mutations, a mutation in a single gene, and if you have a copy of that mutated gene, you will develop the disease almost with 100% certainty, and you'll develop it early in your 30s, 40s, 50s. And the most common gene associated with familial Alzheimer's disease are mutations in this gene called presenilin-1. And then there are a couple of other ones, the amyloid precursor protein on chromosome 21, and this gene called presenilin-2. And later on, I'll try to explain why mutations in these genes might lead to Alzheimer's disease at a young age. Now, for the majority of people who develop what we call sporadic Alzheimer's disease, so not the disease that's, you know, transferred from one generation to the next at a very young age, the main gene that changes your risk of developing the disease is your apolipoprotein E genotype. And so this is actually fairly easy genetics. There's three genes in the population. You get one from your mom and one from your dad. If you have the E2 type, that might actually protect against the disease. The E3 one is the common one that most people have, and about 20% of people have at least one copy of the APOE4 gene, and that's the one that increases the risk of the disease. And if you have one copy of APOE4, that increases your risk about 3 times compared to the general population. If you have 2 copies of E4, that might increase the risk of developing the disease over the life by about 10 times compared to the general population. So it is a significant risk factor. That said, many people develop Alzheimer's disease without having the APOE4 gene, and many people have the APOE4 gene and never get Alzheimer's disease. So it's not a deterministic gene, but it does modify the risk. Again, for reasons that we don't entirely understand, women seem to be more susceptible to this APOE effect than men are, and having APOE4 not only increases the risk of the disease, but decreases the age of onset. So people are more likely to develop the disease in their 60s or 70s as opposed to 80s or 90s. And then there are a whole host of other genes that might modify the risk a bit, but these genes modify the risk about 1.1, 1.2-fold compared to the general population, whereas APOE4 is 3 times, so it has a much stronger effect. Okay, this is the hardest slide that I'm going to show. This is a molecular biology part of the talk, and I'm going to just walk you through it. I don't think it's actually that complicated, but this is... what I'm going to introduce to you is the amyloid cascade hypothesis, which is still the hypothesis about how the disease develops that has the most scientific credibility. And so this is what happens. All of us have this protein called the amyloid precursor protein, or APP. It sits in the membranes of our neurons. So this is the outside of the brain cell, this is the inside, and this is the cell membrane over here. And the normal function of this protein is actually not known, but it seems to have something to do with tuning up or tuning down a little bit the connection between brain cells, the electrical connection. What is known is that the cell can get rid of APP through 2 different pathways. So if we're lucky, we get cleavage by alpha secretase. This is just a cleaving protein, and that creates a waste product that the brain can actually clear very effectively. No problem there. However, if we get cleavage by beta secretase over here, and another cleavage protein, alpha or gamma secretase down here, we get a protein fragment called the A-beta polypeptide. It's about 40 or 42 amino acids long, and this is a sticky protein, so that one A-beta sticks to another. These aggregated or sticky forms of A-beta are actually probably the most toxic forms to brain cells, even though they're still in solution. But eventually, if you get enough of this protein sticking together, you get the amyloid plaques that we can see under the microscope. Now, remember I told you that genetic causes of Alzheimer's disease are due to mutations either in APP or in a protein called presenilin-1, which is part of this gamma secretase complex. And so you can immediately imagine how if you have a gene mutation that predisposes you to produce this sticky protein at an accelerated rate, that will lead to early accumulation of amyloid and to developing the disease at a young age. So this is the cascade of molecular events that's thought to underlie the formation of the amyloid plaques and lead to the disease. Now, why do people believe that amyloid is so important? Well, the first reason is that these sticky forms of amyloid have been shown to be toxic to the brain in every imaginable experimental model from a brain cell that you grow in a dish all the way to a mouse. So a lot of evidence that sticky or aggregated A-beta is not good for the brain. Furthermore, all the mutations that cause genetic Alzheimer's disease in humans are genes that are directly involved in this amyloid cascade. And in fact, if you express these genes in mice, the mice develop amyloid plaques and memory problems. They get Mouseheimer's disease. And so that's not my term, I should say, but it's a pretty good one. And so the genetic data are just very, very strong that amyloid must be important. If you have an extra copy of just normal APP because you have Down syndrome, remember, APP is on chromosome 21, and people with Down syndrome have three copies. Down's patients develop amyloid plaques and dementia in their 40s. It was found in Iceland that some people have a very rare variant of APP that actually can protect them from getting Alzheimer's disease well into their 90s. And then finally, a lot of the risk-modifying genes, those genes that increase or decrease the risk of the disease, are directly involved in the amyloid cascade, most notably APOE, but also others. So a lot of evidence for the amyloid hypothesis, but what about tau? Remember, Alzheimer was more impressed, actually, by the tangles that he saw in the brain. And so what does tau do? Well, this is the tau protein, and it binds to a structure in the cell called a microtubule. So here's a brain cell and neuron, here's the cell nucleus, and here are the microtubules. And the microtubules are actually part of the skeleton of the cell. They give the brain cell its structure, and they're also incredibly important for transporting DNA, RNA, energy from the main part of the cell here all the way down to the distal part of the cell here where the neuron is connecting with other neurons to form synapses or connections. So you can imagine how important this highway system, if you will, is for normal function of the neuron. The tau protein binds to these microtubules and stabilizes them. And what happens in Alzheimer's disease is that there are biochemical changes in the tau protein that lead to the addition of phosphate molecules at all these T and S sites that you see here. And if there are too many phosphates on tau, tau actually disassembles, releases from the microtubules, and starts to stick together, just like amyloid. You get sticky tau deposits that are also bad for the brain cells. And in addition, the microtubules begin to become unstable, and this highway system starts to malfunction. So any of you who had to cross the San Mateo Bridge today know what a bad highway system can do for normal transport. So even though the Baptists have been the majority camp for many years, there's been a vocal minority in the field of Alzheimer's disease who believe that these tangles, the tau tangles, are more important. And what is the evidence for that? Well, as I just said, tau is incredibly important for maintaining microtubule health, for maintaining this highway system in the cell. And just like sticky amyloid, sticky tau is also toxic to brain cells. Furthermore, the clinical symptoms of Alzheimer's disease are much more strongly related to the tangles than they are to the amyloid plaques. And what do I mean by that? Well, imagine two patients. Imagine someone who's in the mild cognitive impairment phase of the disease, and we'll define that later, but someone who has, you know, significant memory problems but is still functioning independently, is able to, you know, by keeping a very close eye on their calendar and to-do list, to function independently, to do okay in day-to-day life. Imagine that patient dies of an unrelated cause, say a heart attack. All right, now imagine a second patient who's had the diagnosis of dementia for 10 years, dies in a nursing home, unable to walk, unable to talk. Well, the patient with severe dementia and the patient with mild memory problems will have a similar burden of amyloid plaques, no difference. But the patient with severe dementia will have many, many more tangles. So the severity of the symptoms really relates much more closely to the tangles than it does to the plaques. Now, if you create a Mouseheimer's mouse, if you genetically engineer a mouse to make this amyloid, but you silence the tau protein in that mouse, the mouse has a lot of amyloid plaques, but they don't have memory problems. So you can actually cure Mouseheimer's disease by silencing the tau protein. Again, evidence the tau is really necessary, the tangles are necessary for the symptoms of the disease. And the tauists have been gaining more and more credibility because, as we'll discuss later in the talk, the therapies that have focused on amyloid largely have failed. In fact, some have failed quite spectacularly to cure Alzheimer's disease or slow it down in human trials. And so as the focus on amyloid has not led to good therapies, there's more and more interest now in thinking about the tau tangles. All right, this cartoon is just meant to show that life is pretty complicated. So here, this is going to review a lot of what we just talked about. Here's a brain cell that's secreting these sticky deposits of amyloid, and that's poisoning this cell over here. Here's an amyloid plaque forming. Here's some tangles forming in the cell. The amyloid plaques actually activate the immune system. So here's one immune cell and another immune cell, and inflammation is developing in the brain and releasing factors that are actually stunning the brain cells and preventing normal transmission. And here's APOE4, which might actually directly poison the mitochondria or the energy-producing part of the cell. So there's a lot going on in Alzheimer's disease. And in retrospect, it seems a little naive to think that if we can just treat one aspect of this biology, we can modify the course of the disease. It might take a combination of different therapies that are each attacking a different part of the biology to actually have effective treatments. And we have a lot of precedent for this in medicine. This was the breakthrough in HIV, right? The triple therapy as opposed to one drug at a time. Same in cancer, you know, multiple different agents work much more effectively than one agent at a time. And Alzheimer's might end up being a similar story. Okay, so now let's get more clinical. And let me tell you about a patient that I saw in my practice. This is someone I saw at the San Francisco VA. He was a 7-year-old veteran. He had diabetes. He had high cholesterol. He sat down in my office and just said, "My memory's terrible, doc." And his wife sat down with him, and she said that in the past 3 to 4 years, she's seen a lot of changes, and I think many people in the room will recognize this story. He's increasingly forgetting conversations they had. In fact, the night before, they had talked about how they were going to come into San Francisco for their memory clinic appointment. He woke up the next morning, no recollection of an appointment, didn't remember the conversation they had had. They had watched, I think, Dancing with the Stars the night before, and they'd become very excited about the result, whatever it was. Next morning, he didn't remember who got voted off. He was repeating the same questions over and over again, sometimes after just 10 or 20 minutes. He was telling the same stories over and over. Now, interestingly, his memory for things that happened long ago, 20 or 30 years ago, was really entirely normal. And in fact, he tended to reminisce more than ever about the good old days. He was a really gregarious, extroverted person, but now when he was in big groups, he tended to fade to the background, didn't like to engage with other people. And the month before that, he had been in his endocrine appointment for his diabetes in San Francisco and had to drive back to his home in Ukiah. And this was a trip he had made many, many times before, but this time he got confused and lost and ended up needing to stop at a gas station and call his wife to come help him. He couldn't figure out how to get home. So this is a very characteristic story of how Alzheimer's disease begins, with trouble with very recent memory, trouble with navigation, a little bit of maybe depression or social withdrawal. Now, people will notice these symptoms evolving over 3 or 4 years, but we think that really this is a process that begins 20 years or more earlier. And it all starts with normal aging. Now, here's some sad news. There are cognitive changes that decline just with normal aging. So things like how fast we process information, some of our ability to think flexibly, to think of specific words, a little bit with memory as well. All these things decline with normal aging. The good news is there are things that improve with aging too, such as our wisdom and general knowledge. Okay. So people are on the trajectory to normal aging, but some people deviate from that trajectory, and they develop the sort of intermediate stage that we call mild cognitive impairment. And that means that their memory or other cognitive functions are declining. You can actually measure that their performance is well below average for their age and education when you do neuropsychological testing, but they're still able to function independently pretty well. They don't need help to, you know, manage their life. And mild cognitive impairment, or MCI, can represent the early clinical stages of Alzheimer's disease, or it can be due to many, many other factors. If it is due to Alzheimer's disease, things progress. And at some point, the cognitive impairment does interfere with people's ability to manage their own life, to function independently. And that's the definition of Alzheimer's dementia. And of course, these are very artificial categories for what is truly a continuum. So if someone is having trouble doing their taxes but can otherwise function, you know, independently, is that dementia? Well, probably not. But there's a gray area here, right, between mild cognitive impairment and Alzheimer's dementia. There's also a gray area, to be honest, between normal aging and early mild cognitive impairment. So this is really a continuum of cognitive performance that we have artificially divided into three categories. So Sergeant M, what do we do as a neurologist? How do I approach this problem? Well, we do some level of cognitive testing, and when we tested him, we found, not surprisingly, that he did have moderate to severe impairment in memory compared, again, to other people of his age and background. We also found some difficulty with other cognitive domains, so some trouble with language function, some trouble with his visuospatial function, some trouble with what we call executive functioning, the ability to multitask or think flexibly or abstractly or make complicated decisions. We do basic laboratory tests. We look at his electrolytes, liver and kidney functions, vitamin B levels, thyroid. These are all things that can lead to cognitive changes and are easily treatable medical problems usually, and all those things were normal. Then we obtain brain imaging, and what you see here on this MRI scan, sliced right down the middle of his head like a loaf of bread. So here's the brain tissue. And you see that the tissue is really thin in these areas here. This is the hippocampus of the brain, an area that's very important for making and retrieving new memories. And so loss of tissue in this brain area is one of the most characteristic findings that we see on MRI in Alzheimer's disease. But there's also loss of brain tissue in other parts of the brain. This is just a statistical map showing areas where Alzheimer's disease patients have less brain tissue than age-matched normal controls. And all these green areas represent areas of brain atrophy in Alzheimer's. So this is the brain. Here's the frontal lobes of the brain here, and the back of the brain here, the parietal lobes and the temporal lobes. So you see that a lot of the loss of tissue is really in the back of the brain, and again in these areas, the hippocampus and the medial temporal lobe, these areas that are incredibly important for memory. And the areas where tissue is lost are specialized for the different cognitive functions that we see declining in the disease. So the temporal cortex, the parietal cortex, very important for memory, of course, in the left hemisphere for language production. Also the left hemisphere, ability to do math in our head, to manipulate tools and devices. The right parietal lobe is very important for navigation and spatial reasoning. We also see a little bit of tissue loss in the frontal cortex, and especially in the lateral part, so the part of the outside of the brain. And these are the brain areas that are incredibly important for these executive functionings. Again, higher order reasoning, complicated decision making, thinking flexibly, focusing and paying attention. The frontal cortex is very important for those things. The areas that are spared in the disease are the areas in the medial part of the frontal cortex, close to the middle of the head. And these are areas that are incredibly important for social and emotional functioning. And I think many of you may have experienced the fact that even when people develop pretty severe memory loss and other cognitive problems, that emotional connection, the social graces are preserved. And that's because those brain areas are relatively resilient to Alzheimer's disease, especially early in the course. I think I'll skip this slide. Okay, so the brain is showing changes, but we're still not directly measuring the plaques and the tangles, these molecular events that are going on in the brain. And so a big breakthrough came when scientists realized that the plaques and tangles of Alzheimer's disease actually leave a signature in the spinal fluid. Changes in the levels of the amyloid and tau protein in the spinal fluid that can help you actually indirectly conclude that plaques and tangles are present in the brain. And so when we ask sometimes patients to undergo spinal taps, the reason is that we want to measure these protein levels. And so there's actually a reduction in the amyloid protein in the spinal fluid in Alzheimer's disease. Now, this might not make sense. If there's a lot of amyloid in the brain, why are the levels in the spinal fluid going down? Well, you can imagine that these amyloid plaques are kind of sinks that are drawing all the soluble amyloid out of solution in the brain, and so there's actually less amyloid left in the spinal fluid. The tangles, or maybe even more so, the loss of tissue and the release of tau into the spinal fluid leads to increases in the levels of the total and phosphorylated forms of tau in the spinal fluid. And if you combine these, say, in a ratio, you can actually, just based on the spinal fluid profile, diagnose Alzheimer's disease with about 85% accuracy. But this is still an indirect measure. And so the next breakthrough occurred about 10 years ago when scientists in Pittsburgh developed a way to actually image amyloid plaques in the brain. So when I was a medical student, I was taught that the only way to know if there was amyloid in the brain was to look at the brain under a microscope after death. This is no longer true. There are now small molecules that can allow us to image amyloid plaques in living patients. And here's how it works. This is, don't worry if you didn't take organic chemistry, but this is a small molecule. And the small molecule has a radio label. It has carbon 11, which is decaying. And this small molecule can be injected intravenously. It binds to amyloid plaques if they're present in the brain, and it sends out a radio signal that we can actually detect using an imaging technique called a PET scanner, which detects this radioactive decay. And what you see here is red signal in the brain. And this red signal represents areas in this brain where amyloid has deposited. How do we know that amyloid is, that what we're seeing on these PET scans relates to amyloid in the brain? Well, here's a study that was done by a company developing one of these amyloid imaging agents for the use in patients, for clinical use. And when they talked to the FDA and asked the FDA, what will it take to approve this technology for use in patients, the FDA said, we want to see evidence that what you're seeing on these brain scans actually corresponds to the amount of amyloid that is seen after death. And so what this company did is they approached patients who were under hospice care, patients who were expected to have 6 months or less to live. They asked them to undergo a 10-minute brain scan during life and donate their brain after death to measure amyloid. And what you see here are the results of this study. So you haven't looked at a lot of these scans yet, but this is a scan that shows no amyloid in the brain. So you see only this green signal. This corresponds to the white matter in the brain. There was no evidence of amyloid during life. And this is actually a slice of the brain after death. And so if there were amyloid, you'd see these purple dots that you see here, but actually no amyloid after death as well. Now here's a patient who showed some signal during life. So see this yellow and red stuff? This is sort of an intermediately positive PET scan for amyloid. And after death, this individual had a moderate amount of amyloid in their brain. And then finally, here's someone with a lot of red signals, so suggesting there was a lot of amyloid in the brain during life. And sure enough, when this individual passed away, a lot of amyloid was found by the pathologist. And so this type of study led the FDA to agree that these scans are very useful for detecting amyloid and to approve them for clinical use about 2 years ago now. Just in the past year, year and a half, there has been tremendous progress in our ability to image the other key player, the tau tangles. And what you see here are PET scans now with a molecule looking for tau tangles. And here is a healthy individual showing only green, so no yellow or red. This individual is not expected to have tangles in their brain. Here's someone with MCI, so, you know, significant memory problems, but still not dementia. And you can start to see now some yellow signals, some early deposition in the temporal lobe, in fact, exactly where we expect the tangles to begin. Here's someone with clinically mild Alzheimer's disease, and you start to see more red signal, more tangles. And here's someone with severe Alzheimer's dementia. You see a lot of red areas, again, in regions of the brain where you expect tangles to deposit. And so we're about 4 or 5 weeks away from beginning our first studies of tau imaging. And for the first time, we'll be able to see the plaques and the tangles together in the same patients to try to understand how they relate to symptoms and how the disease is developing. All right, now how do all these events actually, when do they begin? We talked about the fact that this starts with normal aging and can end up 20 years later with dementia. When do we actually start to see evidence of plaques and tangles in the brain? Well, to answer this question, we're going to go to northeastern Colombia, a district in Colombia called the Antioquia State. And in this area of Colombia, there is a family, an extended kindred of about 5,000 individuals, 1,500 of whom have one of these rare gene mutations that lead to Alzheimer's disease, a mutation in presenilin. They all live there. They develop dementia in their mid-40s. And the expectation in this region is that with about 50% likelihood, people will develop Alzheimer's disease in their mid-40s. And there's really powerful video of this, I think on the New York Times. Through the New York Times you can find it, or through YouTube. Really powerful videos showing how these families are coping with dementia and many, many family members at a young age. And so investigators from Arizona, Eric Ryman and his colleagues, studied these individuals with amyloid PET scans and asked, how early can we detect amyloid? If we know they're going to develop symptoms pretty predictably sometime in their 40s, how many years before that can we see evidence of amyloid? And so here's some PET scans from this study. Here are individuals in their mid to late 20s, and again, no evidence of amyloid at this stage. However, when you're already talking about individuals in their early to mid-30s, see some of this yellow starting to develop? The amyloid's already beginning. Now, these individuals still don't have any memory loss, but you can see a lot of red in different people. So the amyloid is really almost reaching saturation at this stage. And then, as expected, there's a lot of amyloid in the brain once people develop mild cognitive impairment around age 45. And dementia around age 49. So really we're talking about, if you're thinking about dementia at age 50, you're talking about 20 years or more of amyloid depositing in the brain. And this is a nice video by my colleague Adam Fleischer. Let's see if we can get it to work. So here is the age. You're going to watch this green dot. Here's age 20. Remember, people are going to develop symptoms probably around age 40, 45. And in this video, you'll see how the amyloid, if I can get it to work. Sorry, technically challenged here. Let me try one. This should work. Here we go. So now watch this brain. Maybe. All right, I'll give this one more minute. It's pretty cool. It's worth seeing, but if it doesn't work, we'll forget about it. Oh, it's in here. Oh, you can see it. Oh, okay. I can't see it on my monitor. Okay. Well, never mind. Okay, worth the wait. Okay, so this is what happens in individuals who have these very rare genes that cause Alzheimer's disease. Is the same thing, however, happening in individuals who develop the disease without these gene mutations in their 70s or 80s? Does amyloid really begin 20 years before most people with Alzheimer's disease develop mild memory loss? Well, what you see here are PET scans from people in our studies of aging. So all these individuals are cognitively normal. They're about age 70. And these are amyloid scans. So here's someone with no amyloid in their brain at age 70. But here's an individual, totally normal in memory and every other cognitive test, starting to show some yellow here, starting to show some evidence of early amyloid deposition. And here's another individual showing a lot of red signal, a lot of amyloid, very similar to this patient with Alzheimer's disease that you see in the bottom row. So we can, in fact, detect amyloid in about 30% of normal people. Now, does this mean that amyloid is not important, that it's just part of aging, or are these people really in the preclinical stages of the disease? Will they develop symptoms over the next few years? Well, there's more and more evidence to suggest that, in fact, having amyloid in your brain, even in the absence of symptoms, is a significant risk factor for developing symptoms in the next few years. What you see here is an image of the rate of brain atrophy or brain shrinkage in normal people who are amyloid negative on the top and amyloid positive on the bottom, and red corresponds to areas of the brain that are showing accelerated atrophy, more rapid atrophy. And so you can see that those individuals that have amyloid are showing brain shrinkage at a much higher rate than those individuals who do not. Same holds true for memory performance. Here is a measure of memory just at baseline in individuals who are amyloid negative in blue, amyloid positive in red, no difference in their memory when they first enter the study. However, if you follow them over 2 to 3 years, the individuals who showed amyloid in their brain are showing a decline in memory that's much more rapid than those individuals who are negative for amyloid. And so this has really led to the notion of preclinical Alzheimer's disease, the idea that the symptom, that the pathology in the brain, the plaques, might begin 15, 20 years before the earliest symptoms. Here's just another piece of evidence for this. Here's how often we find amyloid plaques, here the solid black line, at autopsy in individuals who are cognitively normal, never had memory problems during life, versus the age of the individuals. Here's the prevalence of dementia based on age of people. And you can see that these two curves are basically parallel with a shift of about 15 years in between them. And so you can imagine that someone who developed amyloid here might be at risk of developing dementia over here. And so this has really revolutionized our thinking about Alzheimer's disease. When Alzheimer's disease was first defined pathologically, clinically in 1984, the thought was that either people were cognitively normal and didn't have plaques and tangles in their brain, or they had dementia and the brain was full of plaques and tangles. And now we know that, in fact, the story is much more complicated and much longer. And here you see how these different changes in the brain might occur as people go from cognitively normal to this intermediate MCI stage all the way to dementia. And so using these types of imaging markers and spinal fluid markers that I told you about, we think that amyloid is beginning to deposit in the brain very early and, in fact, is almost reaching a saturation point while people are still cognitively normal. Next, we think the tangles are beginning to develop in the brain. And again, a lot of this is going on before people have even the earliest symptoms. Next, we think the brain is shrinking, especially these memory areas in the brain are shrinking, and some of this is going on before people have symptoms, but this is really accelerating as people develop MCI or dementia. It's only later that we can actually detect cognitive changes, and that defines the onset of MCI, and then finally functional changes that defines the onset of dementia. And so right now, we're treating Alzheimer's disease over here. Well, people say that might be like treating widely metastatic cancer or like treating someone's diabetes when they're on dialysis. A lot of the action is going on here, and if we could just take advantage of this window where changes are happening in the brain, but the brain hasn't yet lost tissue and people haven't yet developed symptoms, we might be more successful. So moving on to therapy for the last part of the talk, as I told you, a lot of the focus on therapy, I'm not going to discuss cholinesterase inhibitors, Aricept or Namenda. I think my colleague Ron Finley will be discussing those in the afternoon, but I think many of you know the drugs that we have for Alzheimer's disease are not attacking the plaques and the tangles. They're addressing changes in brain chemistry and brain transmitters that occur as a consequence of the disease, and they have some moderate symptomatic benefit. But a lot of the focus of research has been on trying to develop targeted therapies that are addressing the amyloid plaques and the tau tangles, really modifying the biology of the disease. Now, as I've told you, there are a lot of approaches to treating amyloid, and they've been largely disappointing. So, for example, if we could inhibit this enzyme, gamma secretase, that does the second step in creating the sticky protein, that seemed like a very good therapeutic strategy. Unfortunately, two clinical trials have been stopped because of poor outcomes. Other strategies might be to prevent this first cleavage step by beta secretase, and in fact, clinical trials of beta secretase inhibitors are now underway at UCSF and in many other centers. You could also try to promote this good cleavage pathway. Remember, there's one way to get rid of APP where you create a waste product that the brain can actually clear. So if you promote that cleavage step, that might be a good viable strategy. And if you inhibit the aggregation of one amyloid into many other amyloids, that might be good. So these are all different approaches that people have used and thought about to try to address amyloid. Something that got a lot of attention in the last 5 years or so are developing smart bombs, developing antibodies that target amyloid plaques in the brain for destruction by the immune system. So the idea is that the antibody is going to bind to different parts of amyloid. Here you see the amyloid protein, and here you see different areas that the antibodies are targeting, and that will signal the immune system to gobble up the amyloid and clear it from the brain. Now, in the past year, we've had results of phase 3 or advanced clinical trials of two of these antibodies, thousands of patients involved. These were patients with mild to moderate Alzheimer's dementia, and the results are very disappointing. So what you see here are changes over time in the study, over 78 weeks, in a cognitive measure, a memory test largely called the ADAS-COG, and the black line represents the placebo group. The blue line here and the blue and red line in this study represent the drug arm. And you can see that basically there's no difference. Whether people got placebo or got the antibody infusions, their memory was declining at the same rate. So this was very disappointing. But one interpretation of this, again, is that targeting amyloid might not be the wrong approach. It's just that we're doing it too late. Again, the people who were in these clinical trials were studied at this stage. And the thought is that if we can reduce amyloid at this very early stage, if it is indeed the initiating event that leads to all the other badness that follows, we might be much more successful in treating people in the preclinical phase of the disease. And so this has led to the first preventive trials in Alzheimer's disease, and these trials are just getting going now across the world. Now think about who would be the first population, a population that has very little to lose by participating in these trials. Well, these are those individuals who have the gene mutations that lead to Alzheimer's disease at a young age. That kindred in Colombia I told you about. Other people throughout the country who have these rare genes. And so there are two major studies. One is called the Dominantly Inherited Alzheimer's Network. This is really an international registry of individuals who have mutations who might be candidates for clinical trials. And the second is called the Alzheimer's Prevention Initiative. And this is actually focusing on the patients in Colombia and getting them treatment. And so these individuals are now enrolling in clinical trials to get antibodies that lower amyloid, not when they have mild to moderate dementia, when they're 30, 35 years old, when they're still 5 or 10 years away from their expected symptoms. And in fact, a similar study has now been funded in individuals who have two copies of the APOE4 gene, and that study will get underway probably sometime in 2015. Even more revolutionary is this idea that we might actually screen normal older people to see if they have amyloid in their brain. And if they do, begin treating with amyloid preventively. similar to how you get your cholesterol tested. If you don't have any symptoms, you get your blood pressure tested, not if you have a heart attack, but just when you go to your doctor's office. And so this has led to the first preventive trial in the normal population. This is called the anti-amyloid treatment in asymptomatic AD. That's a mouthful, or A4, easier to say, where individuals over age 65 who have a positive amyloid PET scan are randomized to receive anti-amyloid antibodies or placebo. And this is what the study design looks like. Basically, they're expecting to end up with about 3,000 people who are going to go through amyloid scans. Then if they're amyloid positive, they will be told their amyloid status. They will be randomized either to get antibodies over 168 weeks or placebo. And the hope is that giving amyloid at this very early stage can prevent decline. So if you imagine individuals who are over age 65 who are amyloid negative showing this kind of trajectory in their cognition over time, and individuals who are amyloid positive showing this kind of trajectory, the hope is by intervening here, we can actually slow the rate of cognitive decline by treating or reducing the levels of amyloid. And this is an incredibly important study for the field, just started enrolling in the last few months. This is a study that we are also offering at UCSF. Now, I think once you get into the symptomatic stage of the disease, for a lot of reasons, amyloid treatments alone are not going to cut it. And so people are thinking about a lot of other potential interventions. Specifically, what about trying to treat the tangles? And there's a whole variety of different strategies by which we might inhibit the biochemical changes of amyloid. We might actually give antibodies that try to stop the tangles from spreading through the brain. We might give drugs that stabilize the microtubules, that highway system of the cell, even if tangles are present, and hope that the brain cells work better. There are other approaches as well. What if you could modify APOE4 to be more like APOE3 in people who have this genetic risk? What if you could target some of the electrical changes that are occurring in brain networks, say with anti-epileptic drugs? What if we address some of the metabolic changes that we know are occurring in how the brain uses sugar by using things like intranasal insulin or ketogenic foods? And so I'm very excited because there really is now a lot of thinking outside the box and a lot of different strategies in terms of treating the disease. And I do think that it is likely that one or more likely a combination of these will lead to this holy grail of disease modification that we're all seeking. Now, more and more, people are also thinking about treating the risk factors that we know that decades later can lead to the disease. So this was a study by Christine Yaffe and Deborah Barnes at San Francisco VA that generated a lot of interest. And what they did is they used statistical modeling to say, well, how many cases of Alzheimer's could we prevent if we reduced the prevalence of diabetes by 10% in white or 25% in pink? Same thing with hypertension in midlife, obesity, depression, physical inactivity, smoking, cognitive inactivity. And you can see that if we can reduce each of these risk factors or combine them, we can actually prevent many, many cases. This is 500,000 cases of Alzheimer's disease a year. Now, this is, I think, you know, maybe a best case scenario in terms of how they designed their study, but is there actually any evidence that reducing these risk factors proactively, going to this model of preventive medicine, can actually reduce the likelihood of Alzheimer's? Well, I'll end with just a couple of slides that suggest that this might in fact be the case. What you see here is a study from Berkeley looking at amyloid levels. Here they're on the y-axis in Alzheimer's patients. So this is just quantifying how much amyloid we find on a PET scan in patients with Alzheimer's disease. And here's a bunch of 20 to 30 year old young controls, young volunteers. And this red line represents the threshold at which someone goes from being amyloid negative to amyloid positive. So not surprisingly, the patients all have amyloid and people in their 20s or 30s don't. But now I want you to focus on this group. These are older controls and they're stratified by their degree of cognitive activity throughout their lifespan. How often they went to the library, how many books they read in a month, how many cognitively engaging games they play. And what you see is that the people who had low levels of cognitive activity throughout their life are much more likely to be amyloid positive, whereas those individuals who had a high level of activity all had amyloid levels that looked like the 20 to 30-year-olds. Now, that's not to say that people who are very highly educated and active throughout their life don't get the disease. This is, of course, just one factor of many. But it does give some credence to the idea that cognitive activity can have a direct biological effect on the brain and modify the risk of disease. Here's a very similar study out of Washington University looking at exercise. So here, amyloid is on the x-axis. So anyone to the right of this line has high amyloid. Again, everyone here is cognitively normal. And this is the amount of exercise people engage in. And this threshold represents the American Heart Association's recommendation that people exercise 150 minutes of moderate aerobic activity a week. So it's, you know, quite a lot of exercise, but it's doable, you know, three times a week, 50 minutes. So in the low exercise group, as you expect, some were amyloid positive here, some were amyloid negative here, but what was striking is that no one in the high exercise group showed amyloid. Now, these are small studies and small numbers, but they do provide this proof of concept that how we live our life can modify our risk of the disease. All right, so let me wrap up with a few take-home messages. Alzheimer's disease attacks brain networks that are involved in memory, language, visuospatial, and executive functioning. We think the disease is driven by these misfolded proteins that form toxic plaques and tangles, and we think that this process is occurring 10 to 20 years before the very earliest symptoms are present. There's increasing focus on disease prevention, and this thought of a healthy body and a healthy mind, I think, was very wise ancient wisdom that we should, you know, really think about again in 2014. And I think the future of therapy is really going to move towards this model of early detection and intervention with biologically specific agents. So I'll end there, I think, on time. I'm very fortunate to work in two awesome centers, the UCSF Memory and Aging Center. This is actually an old photo. I think we've grown in size by about 20% since this photo was taken 3 years ago. And this is Bill Jagus' lab in Berkeley. Bill is a very close collaborator as well. And so I'm on the Bay Bridge a lot, but it's worth it. I think these are two really invigorating environments to study Alzheimer's disease for a young investigator like myself. So I'll end there. Thank you very much.